If you weren't here last night, what we did, in fact, what Brian mentioned, the 2013 update was the talk I gave last night. I did it for his channel. It was a giveaway at the beginning of the year, and it's a one-hour DVD. I'm in studio doing it, talking about the basically what I did last night. What I'm doing right now is the mid-year update I did on 2014. Let me explain what was going on. After we did the 2013 one, at the beginning of the year, end of last year, they wanted something for what's going to happen in 2014. And so what I did was give signs to look for that were near the end of the time. I was going to get 12 of them, but I only had time to do 7 of them because I got so excited and talking so much in each one. The time was up for an hour, and I only got through 7. So it's called 7 Signs of the End. Now, what happened was, from the time I gave it to the middle of the year, each one of these, as we're going to see, was so much in the headlines, we did a mid-year 2014 one. That's what's out there, and that's what I'm giving today because all that's gone on. Because if you think about it, look what's happened in 2014. Think of some of the headlines that we've seen. We've seen the 50-day operation of Israel in Gaza, Operation Pillar of Defense. At the same time, we see the Temple Institute in the city of Jerusalem calling for a funding for the third temple, an online funding at the end of July. And then let us not forget, this is off the headlines now, but Russia. Remember what Russia did? They came into the Ukraine, a sovereign country, and annexed the eastern portion of it, you know, the Russian-speaking part of it. And then later, of course, that horrific thing, the Russian, people there in that part of the Ukraine shot down that jet to Flight 17 on July 17th in Ukraine, killing 298 people. The flight that was going from Amsterdam to Kuala Lumpur. And that was something that happened this year. But again, Russia going in, taking over a sovereign country, an area that actually has treaties with the U.S. and Britain. And of course, as we're going to see, we're doing nothing and have done nothing with respect to that. And then, the really weird one this year, it's totally off the radar now, we've forgotten, but remember Flight 370, March 8th, that just disappeared? The one going from, going to Kuala Lumpur and just disappeared. And so that Malaysian flight, so we've had two horrific examples this year of Malaysian flights, one that was destroyed, shot down, and the other one just disappeared. That one had 227 passengers on, 12 crew. And we've seen that happen in 2014. Then some very, very, very strange alliances we have seen with this Operation Pillar of Defense. When Israel was attacked by Hamas, we've seen some real interesting things go on, some alliances like with Egypt, Saudi Arabia, and the United Arab Emirates. We'll be talking about that. And then, of course, upheaval in the United States this year at the southern border and all that's been going on that and all the hassle that's been there. And then seemingly out of nowhere came this group, ISIS, or ISIL, or IS, the Islamic State, that has come and done some of the most barbarous acts we can't even imagine, right? And we've seen that happen here in this last year. At the same time, also off the radar, back pages now, and the negotiations going on with 5 permanent members of the Security Council, plus Germany, with Iran to try and stop their nuclear program. They've been working on this for 18 years, by the way. Iran enriching uranium to the place where they want to build a bomb to destroy first the little Satan, Israel, then the big Satan, that is us. And so there's negotiations going on. They, of course, have done things with the economy of Iran. They have certain things that have really kept them hurting bad because of trying to stop Iran from going forward with this. And then if you watch the program Thursday, or you want to do it on video on demand, the technology going at light speed, the Thursday program on his channel, when Dennis Swick, Dennis is the one who put his channel together. He was on with me, and Dennis is a genius with respect to technology. He's literally on the bleeding edge. I'll show you how much, and again, his channel, if you weren't here last night, is a 24/7 Christian TV on the internet. It's Dennis's, goal, his desire, his vision, put it together about 8 years ago, and the Lord has blessed it in ways we can't even begin to imagine with the number of people watching in this. And he is on the literally the bleeding edge of technology. It was funny, they had the a year ago or so, every year they got this annual, tech conference worldwide in Las Vegas. And when he walked in with a His Channel button, the Microsoft people pulled him in into their little tent to talk to him. And Dennis said, "Yeah, I showed him a few things. You know, this is who we're dealing with. You know, the typical genius that and God is." And I'm going to tell you a great story about him and I later. That's just amazing in that. So the technology increasing, then many other things going on. Now, why do I mention these? Okay, because I'm going to give you now the outline of what we're going to be talking about the whole morning, because this is what's happened in 2014. But at the end of 2013, again, I said, look, I'm not a prophet, I'm not a son of a prophet, but here's are some of the things we're to look for. And this was done in December of last year for 2014 to look forward to. And I mentioned seven things. I say what you're going to see, one of the seven signs that points to the end, that the fact that Israel is in the spotlight. It will be on the world headlines. See, the big sign is Israel coming back and forming a modern state in May 14th, 1948. But I also said one of the things we're going to see in 2014 is Israel being in the spotlight of the world. The second thing we're going to see are further preparations to build a third temple, or the Temple Mount will be in the headlines. I said look for that in 2014. And then the lineup of nations in the Ezekiel 38-39 battle, I said, watch them. Watch the coalitions continue to come together. Watch this group, these seven nations plus Russia. Watch this happen, because we're going to see this more and more take place. Of course, and Russia leading the way there, going into the Ukraine. It's almost like what they're doing is a preview of coming attractions, going into a sovereign country and taking something that wasn't theirs. And then also something else. This is... This to me is huge, and I emphasize this when we talk on Scripture. We want not only to read what's there, but what's not there. One of the signs are the nations conspicuous by their absence in this final battle there, because as we're going to see, the nations that are mentioned, none of them border Israel. All of them are away from the border. If you were making this up, you would have the nations that are bordering Israel being part of this. Where are these nations, and why are they not there, and they're conspicuous by their absence? Then what we talked about is no superpower in the world. We assume there's not a superpower in the world, as we're going to see, simply because when this battle takes place, nobody can or will stand up for the side of Israel. And also along that line, there's no strong world leader, no world leader that has any type of with respect to the worldwide respect where people look at, nobody who is, commands that type of respect as we've seen in the past. And finally, technology able to fulfill predicted events, which will be used by the coming world leader. Those are the seven we're going to go over today. Now, I'll tell you what's fascinating. I had a bunch of others. In fact, I had, I think, five more. Now the five has gone into seven more because I keep going. But the next one I was going to mention, I ran out of time, signs of the end. And this was the end of last year. And in fact, 2 months ago when I did the DVD, I mentioned this. The one I was going to say next is, here's what we need to look for in the world, pestilence and plagues. Pestilence and plagues. Wow. See, I'm not a prophet or a son of a prophet, but Luke 21:11 tells us at the last days we will have pestilence and plagues in the world. It will not be something that is eradicated. And you think about it, here we are in the 21st century with all the great minds that are going on, all everything put together, to try and eradicate, bacteria, disease, the such like, with all the antibiotics that have been created. And yet they still remain ahead of us. Now, this comes in two flavors, though. You've got the natural ones that are out there, the plagues and this and that. Then you've got the ones that may be created in the laboratory. Interesting, actually, article today on bioterrorism. There's this, the Washington Post did it this morning, and I was looking at it. And we've been following that, too, this lab in Russia. And they talk about a couple of things in the past where they have developed, and they tried to weaponize the Ebola virus. And so, of course, there's always the worry that what we're seeing today is the weaponization of that. However, and there are people that are arguing that right now, but it seems the spread of this has happened not so much because of the weaponization of it. It's just because of the incompetency of a lot of people around the world. In fact, we have our picture up there of the, but there we go, you got there, there's the CDC. Everybody see that? Yeah, it's This is not real encouraging, is it? Hi there, we're from the CDC. Does that seem like what's going on to you? Have I got this right? All right, yeah, the pestilence and plagues. Yeah, Nigeria, we mentioned this last week on the program, 42 days now, Ebola-free. They had had problems with it. The nations bordering these three countries, Guinea, Liberia, and Sierra Leone, the nations bordered do not have a problem with Ebola. How come? What have they done? Well, this great idea. They've closed the borders. They don't allow people in that have it. And that's kept them from coming to these other countries. And those that got into Nigeria, you think of that as a third world country. They tracked them down. They isolated them. They got rid of it. Now for 42 days, they haven't had any case of the Ebola virus. Interesting, isn't it? And we think, we're so, advanced in that, but fascinating. So the plagues and the pestilence, and if you want to have questions on that, believe me, we've been talking about that every single day. Of course, you know the story, two nights ago, the doctor in New York who had been in the country of Guinea had just returned. He was found to have the Ebola virus, went bowling the night before, rode the subway, went to a couple famous restaurants and that. And today, these places are ghost towns. In fact, a couple of them are afraid they may go out of business because of the stigma there, because it was told he visited that. He had 103 degree temperature when he came in the other day. He is in isolation. And what is fascinating, too, now we mentioned yesterday, if you recall, Governor Christie and Governor Cuomo, because of this, they decided to go further than what the government of the U.S. has done. And they're not only going to monitor people coming in, they're going to quarantine them and isolate them. Now, this is something the government hasn't done, but anyone coming from those three countries. Now, here is sort of the, in a nutshell, the evolution of what went on. First of all, we were doing nothing. And then all the mess that happened with Thomas Eric Duncan there in Dallas, bringing that in. And then the gang that couldn't shoot straight with telling the people in the hospital, we've got it covered here. And we had, fortunately, if you saw the news, Nina Pham, the first nurse that got it, is now Ebola free. That's a great thing. The second one, Amber Vincent, she, according to her parents, also is Ebola free right now. But that hasn't stopped the fear of this coming into the United States. And as we saw, this doctor, Craig Snyder, brought it in, who worked there with the patients in Guinea. Well, what's interesting, we mentioned yesterday, remember, there was a healthcare worker that came also, I believe, from Guinea, that was stopped at the airport there in Newark, and they quarantined her. Now, they didn't want her to even, to enter into the society there. They wanted to give her a 21-day quarantine. Well, last night, she developed a fever. And so they're checking out and they are testing her now for the Ebola virus. When the doctor came in from Guinea, a week ago, 5 days, 7 days ago, he was fine. He had normal temperature, and then just all of a sudden, boom. So this is something that is serious. It's something if wisdom can contain it if you do it right. And we'll just see what happens there. But this is one of the signs of the end, because in Luke 21:11, Jesus said the signs of the end will include pestilence. There will be pestilence and plagues. And what's also fascinating here, when we did the program a week ago Thursday on his channel, the Daily Program, on one day we had three things that were on the headlines. The pestilence of Ebola, the United Nations said because of the pestilence there that may cause a famine, a huge, possibly worldwide famine because of the lack of people there to work the fields because of the virus. And then because of that, the fallout of that is what? People's hearts failing them for fear, the psychological damage it was doing to people. So it's interesting, in one fell swoop, you had three of the things Jesus talked about: plagues, famines, and then people's hearts failing them for fear. So that's why I say we're not sons of prophets or prophets. We're just looking at what the Bible says, right? And here it is, right in the headline. So anyway, I didn't get to that one, but that is one that is there. And then we've got a couple of you asked me about this, about the days of Noah. Well, we've got that going on too. The increase of lawlessness. This is one of the signs of the last days. We've always had lawlessness, but not to the degree we're seeing it right now. People do not anymore care about the laws of God or the laws of man, it seems, anywhere in the world. This is something that's started a generation or so ago, but it's got to the place where lawlessness is just sort of the order of the day. And we've seen it in our country too, haven't we, at the highest levels? Well, the law says this. Well, so what? And then, of course, in our state, California, twice we voted for, you know, marriage equals one man, one woman. What happened? One judge from Northern California, homosexual judge, decided, well, we don't care what the people of California voted for twice, going to throw it out as unconstitutional. And now our state has become sort of the harbinger of everything to come on, you know, same-sex marriage. And now we have other states that, even though have voted against it, because the first 31 states voted for, you know, marriage, one man, one woman. Now it's either unelected judges or a state legislature in their great wisdom saying, well, we're going to overturn all of that. And we've seen all of this change in such a huge way. In fact, there was an article we talked about a week ago on the program from the UK Telegraph in London. And it said this. Here was the title of the article: How Americans Came to Love Same-Sex Marriage. That was the title of it. And, you know, again, this is their perception, but it was fascinating the way they went through what had happened and just so quickly in one generation, how everything changed in this country from, you know, not making it the law of the land to sort of, you know, with the media, with television shows, Ellen DeGeneres, people like that, and politicians coming out. And before you know it now, it's just because of unelected judges like in California who make this pronouncement that says our votes don't count, not once, but twice when we voted for this. And that's what we see right now. Then President Obama last week, just this last week, said gay marriage is a constitutional right. Yeah. Now, where did this all come from? Well, the spirit of the age, the spirit of the day which we live in. So the lawlessness, not even care what the law says, what the people want, this is a sign of the end. And, you know, you wonder why kids don't obey the law. Why should? I mean, you look, oh, this is our thing in the 60s. Why should we? Nobody else is. You know, and the government isn't. They pass laws. They don't even pay attention to it. So that's one of these signs of the last days, too, we didn't get to. Also, interesting, asking about the flood. In Genesis 6:13, it says there was an increase of violence on the earth. Violence on the earth. People's hearts were evil continually. Violence. The Hebrew word for violence in Genesis 6:13 is the Hebrew word Hamas. Hamas was filling the earth. Oh yes, Hamas means violence, the violent ones. And that was the reason for God sending the flood in Noah's day to destroy the world, except for Noah, his family, and their wives. So we see that. Another one, this is a huge one, this is going to take forever too, we didn't get to. By the way, what I'm going to do at the end of this year, I'm going to do these ones now I didn't mention for the second half of this, is the apostasy in the church, the falling away of the organized church from the truth of the Christian faith. It is absolutely mind-boggling what we're seeing with people in positions of leadership in the organized churches in the world, denying everything holy of the Christian faith. We've got the Presbyterian Church, what was it, 4 or 5 months ago, passed the BDS. BDS refers to Israel. Boycott any products that are produced from the so-called, you know, Judea, Samaria, the West Bank, the occupied territories. Then divest any type of investment in there. You boycott the products. You divest any type of, you know, investment made there. And you encourage people who've invested in that area to divest their investments. Then you sanction anybody that still invests in Israel, because they believe there's no plan and purpose for Israel in God's program in the last days. They believe Israel is no longer a player. They look at them as people who don't belong there, who are just horrific to the Palestinians there. And so some of the greatest haters of what goes on, what we're doing right here, is from inside the Christian church. And so we're seeing that. And again, apostasy, the falling away, it's horrific. Some of the as we mentioned actually last week, and the week before, I don't know if you saw the article, it was a week ago, that the Vatican had 200 bishops talking about the family and coming up with some kind of new regulations there. And they made a preliminary statement that said basically, well, you know, maybe homosexuals have gifts they can offer the church. Maybe we should open our arms more wide to them. Now, this is a huge. And in fact, this was encouraged by Pope Francis. Well, the next day, you know, the conservative Catholics went nuts because Catholicism, with all its problems, has really, you know, understood traditional marriage. And saying something like that is just, you know, caused a firestorm. And so when the bishops finally came and finished this little, you know, thing they were writing, they'd watered down what they'd said about homosexuals. But Pope Francis insisted the original language be put in there so the discussion could come next year. People, it's coming. The Roman Catholic Church will accept same-sex marriage, as many Protestant denominations already have. It's here right in front of our very eyes, and it's happened so quickly. So that is another sign, apostasy in the visible church, which leads to, of course, a one-world religion. We see this in Revelation 13, don't we? The final Antichrist and his false prophet buddy. No one can buy or sell without a particular mark on their right hand or their forehead. And as we talked about with Dennis, if you watch the program on his channel from Thursday night, the last one, a World News Briefing, talk about the various technologies that are there. And again, Dennis is on the bleeding edge of these technologies. We had I think I mentioned this last night, an article I got from an Australian newspaper about 9 new technologies that won't be, not like the watch that, you know, Apple's coming out with and Google's coming out with and other groups are coming out with. These are technologies inside your body, not wearable, but that will be inside your body. And when I showed him the article, we talked on the air, he goes, Don, this is caveman stuff. You got to know what's really coming down. And it was beyond spooky, but he had pictures of this because that's what he does. And this is all coming. And so when people ask, what is the mark of the beast going to be? I don't think we have any clue because of the way technology is ramping up so fast. I mean, what sounds like science fiction today is science fact and reality right now. So it's interesting to see this. And so the move towards the one world religion, simply because Protestantism, Roman Catholicism, Islam, they're all seemingly to meshed into one giant, you know, mushy thing where everything seems to be open. There is a rise of a thing called Chrislam here in the United States of America, where on Sunday morning, liberal churches, they read from the Bible, they read from the Quran, and they say, oh, it's one big tent, one big happy family. Well, sorry, not the same God, not at all, but that is what we're seeing. So we've got that going on. Not only see the pestilence and the plagues, the lawlessness, the violence, the apostasy in the church, the move towards a one-world religion, but like we read last night, the unbelievers don't know what's going on. Daniel 12, 10 says, again, the evil will go on being wicked. They won't get it. They are asleep. In fact, what I like is what the old Living Bible said, the original one from Ken Taylor. When he described Luke's gospel, what it talked about, remember Jesus said at the end, they'll be marrying, giving in marriage, planting, sowing, reaping, this and that. I love what he said. He said it's going to be business as usual, business as usual. They won't have a clue what's going on because they'll be so involved in what they're doing. They're going to miss the signs of the times. And of course, the last one, we always start and do this purposely. Israel was the first one mentioned. Israel will be the last of the signs mentioned. Israel will not only exist in the last days. Israel will not only be in the spotlight, but Israel will be on its own. They will have the whole world against them. They will be isolated. And that's another one of the signs. And what's been hugely going on during this time of the 50-day attack from Gaza there against the Israelis, the world looks like in Europe, you've got marches against Israel, people wearing the yellow Star of David like they did in the 1930s when Hitler and the National Socialism came to be. And so you've got all that happening right now, the anti-Semitism on the increase. All right, I'm not a prophet or a son of a prophet, but this is what the Bible says is going to happen. And again, I want you to turn to these passages we looked at yesterday. We're going to look at them again. Isaiah chapter 46, 9 and 10, to remind us what the Lord says about this as we look today about what's happening in the world and how we know we're at the time of the end. So if you have your Bibles, the 46th chapter of the book of Isaiah, chapter 46, verses 9 and 10. And again, as we're turning here, just to note that this is a claim that God is making, the God of the Bible is making, okay? We're not making this up. We haven't said this. This is something we are saying, not something we're saying. It's something he has said. And again, reading from the New English Translation, He says this, "Remember what I accomplished in antiquity. Truly I am God. I have no peer. I am God. There is none like me who announces the end from the beginning and reveals beforehand what has not yet occurred. Who says my plan will be realized. I will accomplish what I desire." Again, these are great verses, people to underline, to note there. God is saying, he's telling them, remember what I've already done in the past. Remember what I've already accomplished, okay? Don't forget that. And he says, I'm God, and there's no one like me. I have no peer. And why is there none like him? Well, for one reason, he tells us ahead of time what's going to happen. So when it occurs, we can know his plan is realized, that everything is under his control. So we see that. That's why he's different from any other God. And then like we did last night, turn over to chapter 48, verses 3 to 6. And still in this argument, in chapter 48 of Isaiah, verse 3, here's what the Lord says. Not what I say, not what you say. Here's what God says. He says, I announced events beforehand. I issued the decrees and made the predictions. Suddenly I acted and they came to pass. I did this because I know how stubborn you are. Your neck muscles are like iron, your forehead like bronze. I announced them to you beforehand before they happened. I predicted them for you so you could never say, my image did these things. My idol, my cast image, decreed them. And then remember last night, we emphasized verse 6. And I love, like I said, how the Net Bible translates this. You have heard. Now look at all the evidence. Will you not admit that what I say is true? You have heard. Now look at all the evidence. Will you not admit that what I say is true? All right, he has made predictions that have come to pass. He did this so people wouldn't attribute it to any other source, idols, like Israel was a want to do. And then he challenges us to examine the evidence. And that's what we are going to do in our sessions today. Let us pray and ask the Lord to be very specially with us. Lord, we thank you. We thank you that you've given us the evidence. We thank you today as we examine it. We know that your word is true, that you are both Lord and God, controlling the future. And Lord, I pray for each and every one of us as we leave this place today, we will be so confident that you exist, that you're in control, that you're running this world according to your schedule, that we will not have our hearts failing them for fear like so many people in the U.S. and around the world are feeling right now. Because we know you are indeed the true and the living God, and you have a program and a plan, and help us understand better what's happening. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Okay, we're going to look now at these 7 points that I mentioned at the beginning of the year that I did the update with. And the first thing I want to do is this, is answer the critics. Now, the critics say, and this has happened somewhat, you Christians do this. You find some event that happens in the world. Then you go to the Bible and try and find some obscure passage to match it up with. That is so unfair to do. And so you don't have really anything that predicts what's going to happen in the future. What you're doing is looking at these things after the fact. All right, we're going to answer that right now, okay? The first one, remember, the Jews will be restored to their ancient homeland. That fact that they came back and formed a modern state in 1948 is something that is the number one sign of the times and that they will be in the spotlight. Let me read you a quotation, another one now. This is from a man named William Blackstone. And here's what he said. But perhaps you say, I don't believe the Israelites are to be restored to Canaan and Jerusalem rebuilt. Dear reader, have you read the declarations of God's word about it? Surely nothing is more plainly stated in Scripture. Let me read this again. But perhaps you say, I don't believe the Israelites are to be restored to Canaan and Jerusalem rebuilt. Dear reader, have you read the declarations of God's word about it? Surely nothing is more plainly stated in Scripture. William Blackstone wrote that in the year 1880. 1880. 1,800 years after the city of Jerusalem was destroyed, the temple was destroyed, the Jews were scattered, sent in exile for the second time across the face of the earth. In 1880, there was no state of Israel. There were Jews scattered throughout the world. There was no interest, seemingly, even at that time. But what he wrote, he said, you mean, don't you believe what the Word of God says? Surely nothing is more plain in Scripture. In the last days, like we saw last night, remember Daniel 12:1, a time for his people, the Jews, in the last days. They're going to be prominent there in the last days. Now, I want you to think about this, how incredible this is, because when that statement was made some 600 years before the time of Christ, the nation was in captivity in Babylon at that time. They wasn't even sure they were ever going to get back to the land, but Daniel was told, as he's reading Jeremiah, that, you know, hey, the 70-year captivity that Jeremiah predicted is almost up. We're going to go back. And they did exactly as the Bible predicted. 606 B.C., it's when the first group was taken to Babylon. 536 BC, 70 years later, the captivity was, you know, over. They were allowed to come back to the land, as the Bible predicted. So Daniel now is predicting basically a second exile there, and then coming back at the end of the age, a tough time for Israel. Okay, think about it. They're going to still exist in the last days, the Jews. When we read the Old Testament, who do we find? Well, we find nations like the Hittites, the Philistines, the Moabites, the Edomites, the Hivites, all around Israel, all attempting to destroy them. Let me ask you something. When's the last time you saw an Edomite? You ain't seen one. They actually stopped existing around the first century. A Philistine? A Hivite? A Hittite? No, none of these people exist anymore, as, you know, with their national identity. They've all lost their identity. They've either become amalgamated with other groups or totally wiped off the scene. Well, how come there's still Jews around? How come they're still around? But see, the assumption there in the last days, they will still exist. This is something that is literally incredible. But like I said, this is not something we're doing after the fact. In the 19th century, and here's sort of what happened historically, people started waking up to the fact that there was Bible prophecy with respect to the last days. And there was a tremendous interest then in the nation Israel that somehow, someday, they would come back into their land. But as we mentioned last night, they would come back in unbelief of Jesus and do certain things before the Lord would come the second time. And that's exactly what we've seen in our lifetime. In the lifetime of many of us, May 14th, 1948, the modern state of Israel was reborn. And when you understand it, against all odds of history, they're back in the land. This has not happened once to them. This has happened twice. Once after 70-year Babylonian captivity, and once after 1900 years. Both times predicted by Scripture, both times literally fulfilled. They have come back. Now, what's amazing about it, and there's so many things amazing about this, in 1948, that's only three short years after the end of the Second World War. It's three short years after the end of the Second World War. In, I'm trying to think of the year it was, 1900, and I think it was in the early 80s, mid-80s, I took my mother, when she was still alive, I would take her on vacations with me. And we went a couple times, went to Australia, Europe, Canada, across the U.S. and that. Well, one time we went to Europe, and I remember very vividly an experience I had. It was, winter time there in Germany. And we were in the city of Munich, and we got on a little train to take us out of the city of Munich for about 20 minutes to a place called Dachau. And I will never forget that as long as I live. We went there to the death camp had been, basically the barracks and that kept rebuilt. They had, this was part of Hitler's final solution, and they had newspapers there of kind of the history of it, where in the 30s, the German newspapers would start separating the Jews, pointing them out, the ghettos, the Star of David, the Yellow Star and that. And I could read German, so I was reading to my mother and translating it for her, and we were going through, and you saw how it went, it's so slowly and surely, they were the ones that caused all the problems. We get out there to the places where the barracks were, and then to the ovens, and it was like it was a cold, miserable day. It's like in the 20s. I felt miserable, but I wanted to feel miserable. I wanted to feel, how miserable it was there. It was so, so hurtful. And it was just hard for me to even comprehend this, that some 6 million human beings were put to death for no other reason than the fact that they were descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And that's what we saw there. But there's good news out of this too. My good friend Hal Lindsey tells a story when he was there at one of the camps. I remember it was Dachau or one of the others there in Germany, maybe some of the ones in Poland. He went there, and I know the feeling. He got to where the ovens were, and he started crying. He just started breaking down. He couldn't help himself thinking of what happened there. And he said, a very old man came up to him and he said, why are you crying? Are you Jewish? And Hal said, no, I'm a Christian. And I just am heartbroken of what happened here during this time of the Second World War. And the man said, let me tell you a story. I was here during the Second World War. I'm a Lutheran minister. And he said, I actually got to lead hundreds of Jews to faith in Jesus Christ before they went to the death there and things. So don't think for one second God wasn't there in that whole final solution. And that was quite a fascinating story. I thought it was wonderful to know that even in the midst of this horrific Holocaust that was going on, God still was saving people for faith in Christ. But here, some 3 years after that, you have in 1948, what do you have? The modern state of Israel was reborn, but almost died in the womb, 1 minute after midnight, attacked by the Arab states, and yet it survived. Again, this is a miracle. If you ever read the story, there's an account, a secular account called Old Jerusalem by Collins and LaPierre that talk about what happened in the War of Independence in 48. Basically, the Jews had like World War I weapons there, and you had the Arab states with all the modern weapons surrounding them. They shouldn't have survived, but they did. It was miraculous, but they survived in 48. The same thing is true in 1967, the Six-Day War. And the Six-Day War, again, the Jews shouldn't have won this war, but they did. They pushed back, you know, and took over, like we mentioned last night, as we're going to mention in a minute, East Jerusalem, the Temple Mount. They captured the whole city of Jerusalem under their control. They should not have won that. Now, the one that was really the miraculous thing was 1973. 1973, the Yom Kippur War. On the most holiest day, they were attacked. They knew it was coming sometime. They didn't know it would come on that day. And it's only the grace of God, literally the grace of God, and the miraculous things that happened that allowed them to not only win that war, but to increase the land that they had there and increase the, you know, the borders of their country. When we were in Israel, one of the last times, our guide, good friend David now, who we're praying for. He grew up with a Christian, he's Jewish Christian family, went to Sunday school and that, but he's turned away from the faith. We've had some good discussions with him, but he told us the story there at the Golan Heights. Syria came down with their tanks all the way to Galilee, and there was no opposition, no resistance. They couldn't understand why. They figured it's got to be a trap. Well, the Israelis weren't ready. So the tank commander, thinking it's a trap, took his tank all the way back to Damascus. Now, the roads are like going up this huge mountain, this huge hill. Can you imagine a tank taking hours to get there, going there? And he finally gets back to Damascus. He says, I think that we're in a trap there. We came right through, and they didn't stop us. Well, anyway, they shot him dead right on the spot for not going through. But by the time the 2.5 hours allowed the Israelis now to come and to reinforce themselves, well, they could have taken over the whole Galilee area. But there are miracles and miracles like that that happened in 1973 war. And if we have time, we'll tell some of the other stories there. But the point is, Israel is there miraculously today in the land because God has brought them there, even though they're there in unbelief. And against all odds of history, they're there, they even exist. But let's not miss this. They exist, they're in the land, they have captured East Jerusalem, they've got the borders which they need right now to fill all these things. So this is one of the great miracles of all history, that they have returned in unbelief, and they are in the spotlight. Now, last night we talked about something else. Remember, we said from Daniel chapter 12, verse 11, the signs that were given there are the sign that Daniel gave in 12:11 when it said we could understand the things at the end, the abomination that causes desolation, what's going to happen in the holy place. And we mentioned in Matthew 24:15, Jesus said to look for the same sign that has to do with a temple and the ceasing of sacrifices. And of course, as good detectives, we said, well, okay, if they stop the sacrifices there, if that's the sign, once they stop the sacrifices, you could start counting time to the end. Well, to stop them, you had to kind of start them in the first place, right? All right, so if they started the sacrifices, that must mean they're Jews, they're there in the land, they've got the Temple Mount under their control. It means there's some type of national state entity, political entity. They are in unbelief of Jesus, obviously, by offering sacrifices. And we looked at seven things. Remember that there are eight things that would be of necessity to be fulfilled if indeed, you know, this is going to be a literal fulfillment. And as we've seen last night, five of the eight have been fulfilled and the other three are set up. Now, I kind of let you hang in last night. Well, what we're going to do is talk about that right now, the campaign to build a third temple. Here's what happened. In 1967, when the Temple Mount was captured, the Israelis 10 days later met with the Muslim, you know, authorities, the Waqf, they're called. They're based out of Jordan. The ones who had control over the Temple Mount had they were the ones who, you know, the administration of the Mount. Moshe Dayan, the defense minister, gave it back to Islam to be under control, and that's been the rule ever since 1967. Even though they flew the Magen David, the Star of David, from the Dome of the Rock shrine there, even though the Jews at that time thought this is our most holy site, we're going to take it over. No, it wasn't God's timing there. Now, at that particular time, there was probably single-digit interest in Israel of taking over the Temple Mount and building a third temple. Why? Simply because they're very atheistic, very agnostic there as a nation. They were patting themselves on the back for all that they had done there. And so they weren't really that interested. But times have changed. And like we mentioned to you last night, since we've been doing our program the last 2 weeks on his channel, the live one, 2 to 2:30 every day Pacific on the breaking news, I've had 17 different stories in the last 2 weeks dealing with the Temple Mount, what's going on there, the idea of coming up and worshiping on the Temple Mount, actually having Jewish prayer there. Because, see, one of the things that happened was the Jews were not only allowed, we're told basically, well, you can go up there, but you can't pray. You can't have a prayer book. You can't worship there. You can't do anything like that on the Temple Mount because the Muslims have control over it, and they're not allowing that. And you don't want to, quote unquote, offend them for a variety of reasons. In fact, kind of a funny story. This is true with Christians too. Christians cannot have a worship service or anything up there. The first time Calvary Chapel of Costa Mesa took a tour to Israel, they got to the Temple Mount, and they were so excited. They didn't know the rules there. So they start spontaneously breaking out, singing, worshiping the Lord right there. And some guard came running over and says, "What are you doing? What are you doing?" And Pastor Chuck said, "Well, we're worshiping the Lord." And the guy said, "No, you can't worship the Lord here. This is a holy place." And they kind of realized what he had said. So no Christian, no Jewish worship, only Islamic worship. Well, there is a bill right now in the Knesset, or it might be introduced, and this is what's been the mess the last couple of weeks there, from one of the ministers of parliament, and she is going to introduce a bill which will allow Jews some type of freedom of worship there on the Temple Mount. This has caused a worldwide response to it. The Prime Minister, the King of Jordan, King Abdullah II, contacted Benjamin Netanyahu, said, "You can't have this. If you do something like this, we're going to get all the nations in the world," remember, isolating Israel, "all the nations of the world together against you." The Foreign Minister of Jordan said, you're asking to foment riots here. You've got that. And of course, Prime Minister Netanyahu caved in. He said, "No, there won't be any change in the status quo. There will be no Jewish freedom of worship, no, there on the Temple Mount." He assured that was like late Thursday. He said that just a couple of days ago. But this is what's been going on. Now, contrary to that, there are a number of Israelis more and more that want to at least go up there, realizing their roots, realizing this is our country, this was our holy place, this was the center of our nation. Why can't we go up there? Why can't we pray up there? Why can't we do anything? And then why can't we build a temple? All right, here's the article. July 27th this year, online campaign does what? Aims to build a third temple. The Temple Institute launches a campaign to build the third temple under the title, "Don't Make History, Make the Future." Now, they're an organization in Jerusalem, which is about 25 years old, working towards the rebuilding of the temple. They prepared some 60 different implements to be used in the new rebuilt third temple that they plan that is going to be there on the Temple Mount there someday in the future. In fact, it was the last trip, or the one before I went to Israel. As our group, they have a whole spiel they go through, dog and pony show of all the tourists that come in about what's going to be happening with the third temple, and I've seen it. So I'm there waiting for all our group to come in, and the guy who's in charge pulls me aside. "Here, let me show you what we've just done," some British guy. And he says, look, he takes me to this room. He says, "This is the altar of sacrifice we've just built for the third temple." He showed me that, and that was like, I think, 2-4 years ago. So they got everything. They got the menorah, the altar of sacrifice. They've got all 60 different implements, the priest's garments, the kohanim, the priest they're training, and all that. And now what they're going to do, now this is what happened. They're doing this through crowdfunding, through people, contributing online, an online campaign for this generation, ready to see the center of Jewish worship rebuilt once and for all. This is what their campaign is saying. And this is happening the same time the Hamas terror was going on, of course, so they're doing this in competition of it. But let me read you what this the promo for this said. It says this: now is time for one of its most ambitious projects yet, completing architectural plans for the actual construction of the third temple. How are they going to do it? Well, they're going to be fusing ancient texts and modern technology, the campaign description states, while strictly adhering to the religious requirements set forth in the biblical text. The third temple will also be equipped with every modern amenity, full computerization, underground parking, temperature control, elevators, docks for public transportation, wheelchair access, and much more. So they're raising, this is what they're getting the architectural drawing right now, what it's going to look like. And these are all the things they're going to incorporate in this third temple. Well, you notice the full computerization and all that. This is something we've talked about for the last 15, 20 years. And it's funny now they're saying that because, as an aside story, before the Temple Institute actually, as I mentioned last night, how, I just happened to be in these places. It was in the 82 trip to Israel where Pastor Chuck said to me, I was on the trip with him, and he said, there's these gentlemen, people that are activists that want to build a third temple. They'd like to meet with us. Do you want to meet with them? And I said, well, what am I going to say? No, of course. And I did. And it's sort of, I just ended up happening to be in a situation where I got involved with these people to find out what they're doing, what they're going on. We mentioned last night we were allowed to go under the Temple Mount before there's any tours ever doing it in the rabbi's tunnel to see the excavation going on underneath the western wall on the Temple Mount, and a privilege to see that and see what's going on there. And so to be part of something like that was quite interesting there. So just, I guess, being in the right place or whatever at the right time or the wrong time, depending on one's point of view. Well, anyway, 25 years ago, before they'd opened this to the public, I was doing a book in the late 80s called The Coming Temple. At that particular time, we got a special visit to the Temple Institute before they had opened it to the public even. And they're putting all these things on the wall, and they had an airbrush picture of the modern city of Jerusalem. They've taken out the Dome of the Rock Shrine, and they put in an airbrushing of a third temple, what it looked like on the modern day Temple Mount with the modern city. They had all those things, and they're putting together this. We got like a 2-3 hour tour, but the thing that was the most interesting back then was a diagram we saw way in the back of the Temple Institute on a wall. And we look at it and we said, well, what is this? And the woman said, well, they've given us the tour. This is an electrician's wiring diagram of the soon to be built temple. And we said, wait a minute, you've been telling us for 2 hours that you're going to do everything according to what the Bible says and what your ancient sages say about the temple. Where do you get a wiring diagram? And where do you see that in the past? And it was really interesting what she said 25 years ago. I've talked about this for years and years, but now this is even more to the forefront. She says, where the sages and the Bible speak, we will follow. But where they don't speak, we feel free to basically, to improvise. For after all, the third temple is not going to be built for the past, but built for the future. Well, one of the things I would mention then during the talks about Jesus' statement we read last night, remember the sign? He said, when you see the abomination of desolation. How are people going to see that inside a temple building? Well, now we know how, aren't they? Because of the full computerization. And of course, with modern technology now, it's a no-brainer. But even 25 years ago, they were setting the stage to have, video, television, and all that inside a third temple. So again, all these things happening amazingly right now. We are not surprised by any of them. But anyway, this is the ambitious project that's going on. And last night, again, just to remind you, this is not something after the fact. We read this quotation, I'll read it again, by Robert Govett. Just as William Blackstone talked about the Jews coming back to the land. We mentioned this last night. While then the temple had been destroyed at the date of the writing of the book of Revelation, it was hereby predicted that it would be rebuilt. Till the Jew is brought back to his own land and the temple and the sacrifices restored, this part of the apocalypse of the book of Revelation does not begin to be fulfilled. The prophetic part does not begin to be fulfilled. And again, as we mentioned last night, Robert Govett, in his commentary on the book of Revelation, wrote that in the year 1861, 1,800 years after the Jews are sent away from their land, the temple and city destroyed, no Jew around anywhere, no Jerusalem, no modern state, yet he talked about, well, someday when they come back to the land, they're going to build a temple and offer sacrifices. When that happens, then this part of the book of Revelation will start being fulfilled. But until this happens, this is still future. How could he say that? And what we said last night, very simple. The Word of God says so. God means what he says and says what he means. It's in his timing. And that's what we're seeing, the stage being set right now. And that's why it's so exciting. We used to joke when Pastor Chuck was with us during World News Briefing the last year or two that we would get now our Temple Mount story of the week. Something every week would come up and talk about something happening on the Temple Mount. Well, in the last 2 weeks, as I'm now doing the daily program, it's been the daily story of the Temple Mount. It's in the headlines every single day. People, this is not a coincidence, because like we said last night, Israel is God's clock. The nation of Israel is the hour hand. The city of Jerusalem is the minute hand, but the Temple Mount is the second hand, because that's going to be the center stage of future world events. And isn't it interesting, here in the 21st century, 2,000 years almost after the second temple was destroyed, the preparations being made for a third temple, animal sacrifices, the whole bit, just as the Bible says. How in the world can that happen? Well, very simple. There's a God in heaven, right, who tells us the future. As we read Isaiah 48:6, look at the evidence. Won't you admit what I say is true? There it is. I mean, what more do people want? And so God is laying out for us all these things with respect to the third temple. Now, someone mentioned last night to me, they asked the question, I said, okay, you didn't mention, yeah, of course I didn't, because I didn't have time. Where are they going to build it on the Temple Mount? We had a question about it being built, the temple stood south of the Temple Mount. Kind of picture it this way. On the Temple Mount, the Dome of the Rock Shrine, you've seen the picture. It's the highest point on the mount. If you walk out the gate there and you start walking down, there's a pretty steep hill. You go about 500 yards or so, a few hundred yards down the hill. They've been doing excavation the last 12 years. And this was the old city of David. And that's been excavated. Actually, this old other story. They found some amazing things there from the time of David. The time, you know, of that, and the time of the destruction of the first temple there, way down below. But David, remember, built his palace down below, because the Jebusites had the Temple Mount. Only later, he got it under his control. So his palace was built further to the south. The temple wasn't built there. It was up on top of the mount. The question is, where on the Temple Mount will it be built? And real briefly, there are four possibilities. We don't know where it's going to be built, simply because you can't do any excavation there on the Temple Mount. Now, it shows you how God's got a sense of humor there. Here is how, today, Islam denies there was ever a temple there in the first place on the Mount. It's a Jewish myth. There never was a temple there, except their guidebook in 1925 talks about it, you know, that there was a temple here. They willingly, conveniently forget that. But now they're saying in the last generation, this has always been an Islamic holy site. There was never any temple there. No, there was. And they didn't, you know, they dissed the idea there was one. Well, in the last decade or so, what was interesting, They didn't ask. They said, we want to build an emergency exit outside of the area on the southern steps of the southern area of the Temple Mount. And what they did, instead of building this little emergency exit to one of the mosques, they built this huge, huge, huge thing where they took something like 40 tons of dirt away. 40 tons of dirt on the most holy site in the world. No archaeological excavation, no sifting through. It just took up bulldozers, pickup trucks, and that, and dump trucks. And they went over to the Kidron Valley and dumped it all out. Just dumped all this out. Priceless artifacts there. And dumped it out. Well, some sharp Israelis put the yellow tape around the area and started sifting through. And what did they find? Well, it was interesting what they found. They found there, at this little dump site from the Temple Mount, a certain arrowheads there that were used from the catapults of the Romans when the Romans destroyed the second temple in the year AD 70. Unique to that time, unique, and we know, you know, it fits what we know from other places. The Romans use this for a certain period of time, certain of the devices they use, showing that the Romans did destroy the second temple. And then even better than that, arrowheads from the destruction of the first temple by the Babylonian. Babylonian arrowheads were discovered there. And so when they tried, you know, to build this exit, they've been not denying there was ever a temple there. What do we see? Indications of not only there was a first temple, but a second temple also destroyed by the Babylonians and by the Romans. God has a sense of humor, doesn't he? Because those things that were found give definite objective evidence there was a first temple destruction, there was a second temple destruction, by the Babylonians and by the Romans, and the evidence is right there. I mean, again, if people would just open their eyes to all of this. All right, I've got through number two, sort of, and we're time for the question and answers here. It's already 10:30. Can you believe it? It goes fast, doesn't it? Or is it just me going fast? No, it's going. Well, I'm going fast too. But okay. Let's do this. Let's take about 15 minutes or so and answer some questions. Then we'll take a break. Then we'll go up to the top of the hour, and then we will go straight through. We'll try and finish the other five more or less till lunchtime. Okay. So if you have a question, we come up to the microphone. Do we have any of those written questions too, Brian? You can check if we have those. And again, if I don't know the answer to the question, I'll just, you know, I won't make anything up. I just say I don't know. And you've asked some great questions. Yes, sir.
While we're checking, I'll ask a question.
Sure.
We talked a little bit last night. What books, websites, resources, and such, you know, on top of course, his channel, would you recommend that we read or look into to keep up on things
okay,
like this?
Yeah, there's very few of them I can recommend. What I would do... For Christians, Hal Lindsey's stuff, by far. Hal's is the best. HalLindsey.com, I think it's .com or .org. He has a daily update of the events that are there. Hal has been doing this for, you know, so many years. He's got a good balance on all things. There are a number of Israeli papers sources, thank you, that we refer to, but this gives the Israeli point of view. Israel National News is one of them, the Jerusalem Post, we've got some other ones there. I can give you a list if you're interested in that later, but particularly the Jerusalem Post, Israel National News. And there was a military intelligence one, Debka, D-E-B-K-A, Debka.com, and that's been excellent. But the guy who's in charge of that, the analyst, I guess, has got some sickness or had to go to the hospital, so the site there has kind of been put down. It's for the last month or so, and they had some really, really insightful things. But, you know, Israel National News, Jerusalem Post, but for Christians, Hal Lindsey. And again, if you weren't here last night, we mentioned again this morning, on his channel, not only every Thursday night, a world news briefing for 1 hour looking at the events of the week, but now every day from 2 to 2:30, I'll be doing in real time breaking news, what's been going on with the latest stories there. So that ought to keep you up to date. All right. Here's the first question. What are your thoughts on where Isaiah 17 to 19 fit in the prophetic timeline, especially related to Ezekiel 38 and 39? Do you see Isaiah 17, 18, and 19 for the general time period, or do you see it happening between each event? All right. Stay tuned after the break. That's what we're going to do with the next point. When we talk about that, you guys are anticipating Ezekiel 38 and 39. We're going to talk about that and the nations around him. So, Kirk, great question. You guys are a sharp group. You're anticipating what I'm doing here, so that's coming. All right, anybody got a question today? Or if not, I got questions for you. So if you don't have any for me, I've got a bunch I'd like to know the answers to. Just come up, use the microphone. If I don't, again, don't know the answer, we'll just say we don't know. Anybody? Let's not be shy. Come on. Here we go. All right. First gentleman coming up.
I'm Jason.
Hi, Jason. Weren't you here last night, Jason?
I was, yes.
You look very familiar. Okay, what can we do for you, sir?
Well, you definitely touched on some stuff that I asked about last night with the Temple Mount, but could you speak specifically to the leadership currently, the administration right now, Netanyahu, and do you feel like this is the administration to make these things happen with all the roadblocks that...
Yeah, great question, Jason. Now, there is a minister of the Knesset by the name of Moshe Feiglin, and he's the person you need to keep your eye on. He is someone who is a very deep thinker. He is someone that says we need not only prayer on the Temple Mount, we need a third temple built. He is not some, you know, wide-eyed kook, and he's got a lot more interest now. In the latest poll in Israel, one of the polls had the leader of the Jewish Home Party, Bennett, actually given more, a higher rating, favorability raising than Benjamin Netanyahu. No, I don't think it's going to happen under Netanyahu. I think there's going to be something that happens. And we're going to be actually talking about that after the break, because we're going to see in the third sign how all of this seemingly is going to come together to allow a third temple to be built. We'll talk about that with Ezekiel 38 and 39 of invasion. No, and actually I think now just the opposite, because all that's going on, you've got riots on the Mount, you've got Jewish people that going up there that are being spit upon, that, you know, being cursed at, rocks and bottles thrown at them, the Israeli police have to shoot tear gas to get them off the Mount, and yet Prime Minister Netanyahu assured King Abdullah, oh no, we're not going to change the status quo. It's going to be the same. In fact, I tell you what's so horrific. It was, what, 2-3 weeks ago, in this other gesture of goodwill, why they do this, only God knows, they're going to allow at least 500 people from Gaza, the Gaza terrorists, to come and worship on the Temple Mount. I mean, you won't let your own people even pray there, but you're going to let these people who just attempted to murder you come and worship there on this site that is your most holy site? By the way, this was not an Islamic holy site till recently in its history. It's never mentioned in the Quran. It was never a holy site earlier in most of Islam's history. It's only the last few centuries where they made Jerusalem something central there. In fact, what they would do in the early years, they would pray to their backs towards Jerusalem when they faced Mecca. And in fact, we have pictures of this. It is interesting. With the Dome of the Rock shrine, you see all these Muslims bowing. When they, you know, bow to the east to pray, you know, thousands up on the mount, their backsides are facing, you know, the Dome of the Rock there. You know, so much for, you know, accepting it as a holy place, right? But that is part of their religion, just as the past couple of hundred years. And they found one portion of the Quran where it said Muhammad, you know, went up to heaven from, he ascended to heaven from this distant place. And in the last couple hundred years, they made Jerusalem now the distant place. So it's become their third holiest site after Mecca and Medina. It was not in their whole history a historic religious holy site. It's become that, particularly because the Jews are back there, and they, you know, and the Jews again are talking about certain building a third temple, and that is, you know, according to Islam, that's never going to happen. In fact, you know, a man who is a relatively peaceful man, King Abdullah there from Jordan, said, you know, don't you do this because we'll get the whole world against you. Well, didn't we mention number 15, the last of the signs of the last days, the whole world's against Israel? And we're seeing that right now. So isn't this interesting? All these things coming to pass. But just think of the two things we've mentioned this morning, just these two. Number one, that in the last days there will be a modern state of Israel, that they will still exist. And number two, and there will be in the headlines, but also that there'll be a desire still at the end of the days to build another temple. Can you imagine the odds of that happening by chance, how seemingly impossible it is? And can you imagine the ridicule certain people receive the last 200-300 years? Because I got a whole bunch of quotes from people that say this is going to happen. How they were looked at when they said, you know, there's going to be, the Jews are going to come back to their ancient homeland. They're going to form a modern state. They're going to build a temple and offer sacrifices. Can you imagine how crazy these people must have looked in the eyes of the world and their fellow believers? Because they say, wait a minute, what are you talking about? This can't happen. Well, like William Blackstone says, dear reader, have you read the Word of God lately? Nothing is more clear. It's going to happen. As Govet says, until this happens, this part of Revelation can't be fulfilled. We believe it's going to be fulfilled literally, because the first time Jesus came, he fulfilled literally everything God had predicted the first time. Why would it change the second time? In other words, the first time he was born in the right city, Bethlehem. He was born in the family line of David. He came before the city and temple were destroyed, which is a whole other subject. But bottom line is, he fulfilled exactly what was said the first time around. Why should we expect the second time around God not to say what he mean or mean what he says? Why would we not expect him to do exactly that? And this is the logic these people had. But let me tell you, folks, they were few and far between. There weren't many of them out there saying this, but they believed it, and they trusted God's word. And just like we read in the book of Hebrews, all these died in faith, not seeing the promise. That's why it's so exciting to be alive today. We're seeing it right in front of our very eyes. And as you can imagine, even the time we're going to have today, we won't even begin to skim the surface at all that's there. And that's why I said, if you can't get excited like this and you're a believer, we're going to have your pulse checked afterwards and see if you're still alive, because this is a very, very exciting time to be alive. Okay, any other questions? Because we're about up to our break time. Anybody else? Okay, we got one young lady here wants to ask one. Then we know you guys have been sitting around for, boy, we started what time? An hour and 40 minutes? We've been doing that long here? Wow, you're good. Okay, yes, ma'am. Carol.
Are we going to be talking about how the Dome of the Rock will be displaced?
Okay, well, we can now. Okay. Yes, actually, yes, we are. That's the next point. Okay, let me save that, because I think we've got a scenario that might work on what will happen with the Dome of the Rock if that's the site of the first and second temple where the third temple will be built. We'll save that. Yes, ma'am.
I was on a tour of Israel with Chuck in the 80s, and I remember him saying, which must be what you're talking about, is that the temple could be rebuilt without touching the Dome of the Rock.
Yeah, and here's, let me, yeah, I should have continued. Thank you. actually, there was a Jewish physicist in the 80s, a man named Asher Kaufman, who became a very good friend of mine. And when he came to America, I actually picked him up at the LAX airport and brought him there to Chuck and introduced him. And we had him speak in Calvary Chapel and some of the groups. Again, just kind of being, I don't know, the right place at the right time. Asher became a very good friend. He was a physicist, and he actually developed this gun sight for the Second World War to help the fighters of the Pacific, cut down the glare. He's a plasma physicist. As he was retiring, he wanted to see, if he could determine where the temple stood. And he came, to make a short story long, what happened was he came to the conclusion that the traditional site isn't correct. The Dome of the Rock, there in the midst of the Temple Mount, is not the site. The actual site is 106 meters or 330 feet to the north of the Dome of the Rock in a place called the Dome of the Spirits or the Dome of the Tablets. And what's fascinating about his theory, the modern Eastern Gate or the Golden Gate, where you're supposed to be able to look right through the Golden Gate and right into where the temple was and the Holy of Holies. Well, where the Golden Gate is today, the one that's, again, this isn't the original Golden Gate, but the one, the Eastern Gate on that side, well, it lines up perfectly with his point of view. It doesn't line up with the Dome of the Rock. In fact, if you're there on the Mount of Olives, and you're supposed to be looking there straight from the gate right into where the temple was, if you look there, there's no lineup with the Dome of the Rock. But if you look, you go over a little bit, 106 meters to the north, right perfectly. In fact, we were up there. Asher took us up on the mountain. He said, look at this. Right here, and he had it to the perfect physicist. Right here, look at this. It's the fifth crenulation. He's trying to tell me all these technical things. Just look right here. Right there, see where the Golden Gate is? Look there, see the Dome of the Spirit? See where? Perfectly lined up. And that and many other things convinced him about the, that's where the temple stood. Now, that could be true. There's no excavation allowed today. Those are two of the possible sites. We met an Israeli architect, Tuvia Sagiv, who said, no, it was built further on the southern part of the mount, near where the Al-Aqsa Mosque is. You've got the Dome of the Rock there on the mount. Then you go further towards the south, and there's the mosque that's there, the gray building. He said it was built more further to the south there. And so you got these competing theories. We just don't know. We don't know because you can't do any first-hand work. I tell you what was interesting. I'm going to tell you this one thing. We'll take a break here for our mind can take what the seat can endure here. Asher, he took me. I went on the Temple Mount with him a few times. It was quite an interesting experience because all the Muslim guards knew who he was, although he tried to make friends with him. And he's a nice, quiet old guy, and so he's up there, and I'm walking around with him. And he said, okay, okay, Asher, there's a very old tradition, I think it's Maimonides, one of the old Jewish things, that the Ark of the Covenant was buried under the Chamber of Wood. Where would the Chamber of Wood be, according to your view of the temple? Because let's walk over here. And we walked over there, because you got to kind of be inconspicuous there, because they don't want you, they're looking at you all the time. And he kind of stood there, he goes, right here, it'd be right below here. I said, really? I go, yep. If his view of the temple's right, if that ancient tradition's right, he said the Ark would be built, would be hidden right below here on the Temple Mount. I said, okay, stay tuned, people. Got a lot more on that subject going. All right.